udah nambah area
Iya.
lagi. Udah
Ya.
terkenal.
Sekarang anggur di Indonesia pun sedang maju sekarang. Tapi mereka yang jual-jual anak pokok itu terlalu mahal, seperti di Malaysia juga. Ya,
Iya.
Malaysia 200 ringgit anak anggur.
Mahal 200 ringgit sama 8, hampir 1 juta rupiah.
Ya, di Indonesia pun mahal juga. Kalau banyak pengusaha-pengusaha itu jual melalui internet.
Iya.
Ya, murah
Iya.
sedikit dari Malaysia lah, tapi masih masih mahal. Ya, mereka kan bisnis. Orang
Yo.
bisnis ini making money. Kita ini kan amal jariah.
Amal zariah ya.
Ya, jadi kalau
Kalau orang
saya jual, mereka marah. Saya kata saya bukan bisnis, saya amal jariah. Lihat ramai orang tanam anggur. Mereka jual 200, saya 20 ringgit saja.
Wah, diborong dong, Prof.
Upah penat saja.
Upah penat aja.
Ya, polybagnya, komposnya. Sekarang kompos buat sendiri loh.
Airnya.
Ya, sekarang kompos buat sendiri.
Ya.
Kalau beli pupuk organik, oh mahal juga.
Iya, Prof.
Jangan
Di sini
jangan
juga
beli,
mahal.
Prof. Harus
Ya.
buat, kalau pupuk organik itu harus buat sendiri.
Betul.
Iya.
Siapa nama yang Pak yang di Bogor tuh? Jual pupuk.
Oh iya, mahal.
Dia bisnis.
Ya, nanti saya bilang bahwa organik itu tidak mahal kalau dibuat sendiri.
Ya, jadi
Ya.
saya buat dari pupuk
Ya, itu
kuning,
yang kayak pasta-pasta itu yang mahal sekali ya, Prof.
Iya.
Jadi petani itu tidak mau pakai organik kalau
Ya.
harganya mahal.
Bikin sendiri
Padahal
loh.
kalau dibuat, ya
Kita ajarin bagaimana
kalau
membuat
dibuat
IM1,
murah.
IM2, IM3, IM4, kita ajar mereka. Ya, guna IM4 saja. Semulanya jam berapa? Jam 10 ya?
Ya. Ini apa?
Mohon izin, Pak Prof.
Dokter
Mulainya
Hanilen
jam
sudah.
10. Pukul 10 pagi.
Bagaimana Bu nih Dokter Hanilen sudah join? Coba dilihat.
Yes, Princess Risa, I'm here.
Ah, ya, good morning, Dokter Hani.
Hello.
I have a nice day.
Mamani join already.
Can you see his picture? The picture.
Yeah. Yeah, the picture, the videos.
Yeah, audio. The audio.
Dr. Hani.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, yeah.
What is going on, Biko?
Yeah, we just had typhoon 2 days ago. That's why we don't have power right now. But
yeah.
I already sent my video presentation to Karina.
Oh.
So she will just play it. But I will be on standby for the questions and answers.
Yeah.
I need to save my bandwidth because of the internet is not yet stable here, and there are so many houses that are still flooded in the Philippines.
God.
Like only you can only see the roof.
Your house is okay?
But our house is okay.
Good.
We live in a higher ground.
Yeah.
So we are safe, but many parts of the Philippines are not safe. They are still flooded until now. Their houses are submerged in water.
God.
It will take some time.
I heard that there is a strong typhoon, yeah, Dr. Hani.
Yeah, we had 5 strong typhoons in 1 month. So that's why we are having a hard time to recover. Many trees were down, electric posts are down. So that's the situation in the Philippines right now. But we are trying to recover. So how are you all?
I'm okay.
We are doing well, ma'am. How about CBSUA, ma'am?
CBSUA. We suspended the class until end of, and asynchronous classes were suspended because their homes, their houses were damaged by the typhoon. Some do not even have houses right now. So we have to suspend the class until the end of the month.
Okay. So you use the online learning also, madam?
Online learning was suspended because we don't have stable internet connection because some houses were still flooded and there's no electric, there's no power yet in most houses. So I'm just using my data now for this webinar.
Okay, madam and all participants for today, our international webinar. Before we begin our international seminar, international webinar, we are from the committee would like to play some video for the entrepreneur, the small entrepreneur. Okay, so for the committee, for play your video. Time is yours for committee. Thank you.
COVID-19 telah memporak-porandakan perekonomian dunia. Sektor pertanian pun ikut terimbas. Produk pertanian tidak mampu diserap oleh pasar. Untuk memperpanjang daya simpan, produk pertanian berupa bawang, cabai, rempah-rempah kami jadikan bumbu rajang. Bumbu rajang, bumbu khas masakan Bali. Untuk mempercepat proses memasak berbagai macam masakan,
produk from asem, betutu,
ikan nyanyat, dan lain-lain. Bumbu rajang merupakan warisan leluhur yang perlu dilestarikan sebagai kekhasan kuliner Bali.
Saya Iwayan Wahyudi selaku owner Agro Wisata Wayang Hati Saka yang juga di bawah binaan program Studi Ilmu dan Teknologi Pangan Universitas Dharmadewa. Di sini saya belajar budidaya lebah khusus Tetragonula reticep atau klekel dan juga menyediakan vegetasi untuk meningkatkan kualitas dan produksi madu yang dihasilkan.
Berbagai vegetasi juga ada yang berbunga sepanjang tahun dan juga ada musiman. Ratusan koloni dan ratusan vegetasi juga ada.
Okay, those are the micro, small, and medium enterprises in Bali, special. And then one of all those micro, small, and medium enterprises was come from our lecturer also, Mam Gemu, as we know that, according to the video. So we think this like the product of agriculture combined with the digital marketing will be the important thing that all people should know about that, should know about step, what they did, how to promote and like how to make some product of the agriculture and then also promote that on their digital marketing. And then the special our international webinar will arrive from the founder of Pak Tani Digital. Pak Tani Digital is one of all Android application there were applicable to bring the farmers to promote their product of the agriculture. So our international webinar will, I think this is will special because Iksa from the Pak Tani Digital founder will combine with Dr. Hanilin from Philippines and then also Prof. Bokhari. So ladies and gentlemen, our international webinar will begin for a few minutes more.
Halo. Baik. Attention, the online seminar is about to start. Please turn off your microphone during the session. Om Swastiastu. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. The most honorable Mr. Insinyur Dewa Nyoman Satguna, Magister of Agribusiness as the Dean of Agriculture Faculty in Warmadewa University. The most honorable as the first Vice Dean of Agriculture Faculty in Warmadewa University. The most honorable as the second Vice Dean of Agriculture Faculty in Warmadewa University. The most honorable as the third Vice Dean of Agriculture Faculty in Warmadewa University. The most honorable Mr. Mahendra Tata Sitepu as the founder Pak Tani Digital from Indonesia. The most honorable Mr. Professor Dr. Bohari M. Yamin, National University of Malaysia. The most honorable Mrs. Dr. Hanilin Aguilar Hidalgo as the Associate Professor Faculty of Agribusiness College of Economic Management Central Bicol State University of Agriculture, Philippines. The Honorable All Lectures Round Agriculture Faculty of Warmadewa University and all participants. Praise our grateful to the presence of our good for giving us blessings and healthiness that we can gather today, Saturday, 14th November 2020, in the event of webinar International Agriculture Faculty of Warmadewa University with the theme Strategy for Creative Industry, Farmers in the Middle of Pandemic and Utilization of Digital Marketing. Ladies and gentlemen, before we begin, let us pray together to our belief so that I hope our good will give us benefit through this event. Let's pray together. Thank you. First of all, let me introduce myself. My name is Aulia Rahmati Ramadona. As the host of the event, I will present the agenda for today. We start with the first agenda is opening. The second agenda is greetings from the Dean of Agriculture Faculty of Warmadewa University. Next, present from profile moderator. Next, present from Ms. Hendra Trapta Sitepu. Next, present of Mr. Professor Bohari M. Yamin. Next, present of Mrs. Dr. Hanilin Aguilar Hidalgo. Next, discussion session. Next, close. Before we begin, I'd like to give a quick overview about our today's seminar. Today we have three important guest lecturers that will provide us with information regarding strategy for creative industry in pandemic situation, especially in agriculture section. First, please we present our dean, the of Agriculture Faculty of Warmadewa University. For Mr. Saguna, time is yours.
Okay, how you hear me? Hello.
Hello. I'm here.
Ya, saya dengar.
Okay. Thank you very much to the Master of Ceremonies for the time given to me to deliver a welcome speech at the international webinar today. Good morning, the participant of the international webinar, the Faculty of Agriculture, Warmadewa University. Om Swastiastu, Assalamualaikum Rahmatullahi Wabarakatuh, Om Namo Buddhaya, healthy and prosperous for all of us. The first time, I want to say hello and thanks the speakers at this international webinar, namely the Honorable Professor Buhari from the University Kebangsaan Malaysia, Honorable Associate Professor Anilin Hidalgo from Central Bicol State University of Agriculture, Philippines, and Honorable Mahendra Tlapta Sitepu, the founder of Pak Tani Digital Indonesia, who has pleased to take his time to fill in this international webinar event. Praise to be God for his grace to all of us so that today we can be brought together to take part in an international webinar that discuss about strategy for creative farmers in the middle of pandemic and utilization of digital marketing. Of course, as the leader Faculty of Agriculture, Warmadewa University, as very proud, where our students have the opportunity to pay attention to the fate of farmers as the effect of the COVID-19 pandemic, which of course they are also affected, and also demanded to be able to take part productively, but must be free from the COVID-19 transmission. We welcome the participants of this international webinar, where we have the opportunity to share information about various strategies to improve our ability to make various efforts in order to be productive in applying agriculture innovation technology, but must be free from the impact of COVID-19 transmission. Through this activity, it is also hope that it can provide understanding and transmission of various creative and innovative methods or strategies, and can meet the demand of the development of science, technology, socio-economic, and culture, especially the welfare of farmers. This international webinar was made possible with the help of various stakeholders. For that, thank you very much, such as to the speakers, committees from student organization and sponsor. Finally, I hope the participation of this international webinar can get the benefit from this activity so that they are able to understand and apply productive, innovative, and sustainable farming method and free from COVID-19. Om Santi Santi Sandi Om. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Healthy and prosperous for us. That's my speech. Then the time return to the committee. And then I ask permission to leave this meeting because I have some activities to do. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Satna, for the opening speech. Now, we continue to the session from our special guest. Before we begin, let me now you a little of moderator today. His name is Bonifacius Dureng. Organization Experience and Certificate 2017 Participant of SI Competition Belfast Diponegoro University 2018 Participant of Philippines Survey Course BICOL Philippines and participant of UNESCO Global Program on Education for Sustainable Development 2019 International Essay Contest for Young People Tokyo, Japan. 2019, participant of International Leaders Model United Nations Bangkok, Thailand. For moderator, time is yours.
Okay, thank you so much for the chance. Thank you so much for the chance from the committee of this international webinar. So ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our international webinar today, 14th November 2020. So thank you as a moderator. I will handle our international webinar today from the presentation from all our guest lecturers today and then until discussion session and then also for the resume of our international webinar today. So ladies and gentlemen, today our international webinar brings some special topic and then this topic we think that it's very wonderful to discuss and applicate it into our daily activities during this middle of pandemic or COVID-19. With the topic is strategy for creative industry farmers in the middle of pandemic and utilization of digital marketing. And then our international webinar today will bring the three of guest lecturers. The first of all, Mr. Mahendra Tlapta Sitepu, as a founder of the Pak Tani Digital from Indonesia, with his topic is about Pasar Digital, Alternative Solusi, Sengkarut Tata Niaga Produk Pertanian. And then the second one, with the special guest lecturer today from the Philippines, Dr. Hanilin Aguilar Hidalgo, as Associate Professor Faculty of Agribusiness College of Economics and Management, Central Bicol State University of Agriculture, Philippines. With the topic, Developing Creative Agribusiness Ideas in the New Normal. And then the last, our guest lecturer today, our international webinar, will bring from Malaysia, Professor Dr. Bohari Muhammad Yamin, from National University of Malaysia with her topic. His topic is about growing table grapes in a limited area during the COVID-19 pandemic. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, because the speaker has already been here, so the first chance, the first stage we will give for the speaker or the guest lecturer to present their topic to us through this Zoom meeting clouds. So the first stage we give for the founder of Paktani Digital from Indonesia. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Mahendra Klapta Sitepu. For Mr. Mahendra, time is yours.
Selamat pagi. Good morning all of the audience. Salam sehat di tengah situasi pandemi corona ini.
Good morning, sir.
Izinkan saya pertama sekali menyampaikan semoga kita dalam keadaan sehat-sehat di tengah situasi pandemi ini dan tetap optimis bahwa awal tahun depan pemulihan di segala sektor, baik ekonomi, sosial, budaya, dan segala macam itu akan mulai terlihat dan kita akan kembali memulai kehidupan yang lebih normal kembali. Pertama sekali, perkenalkan saya, memperkenalkan diri, saya Mahendra Sitepu, seperti yang disampaikan oleh moderator tadi, founder dari Paktani Digital, marketplace pertanian yang berusaha untuk menginisiasi solusi mempertemukan petani dengan seluruh stakeholder bidang pertanian. Baiklah, saya akan langsung mempresentasikan sedikit mengenai apa yang sudah kami lakukan, Paktani Digital, kurang lebih 2 tahun terakhir ini. Saya akan slide presentasi akan saya sampaikan di sini. Host atau moderator, saya sudah dibuat jadi host di sini.
Sudah, Pak.
Baik.
Sudah, Pak. Ready.
Baik, sudah oke ya materi presentasinya ya. Jadi Paktani Digital itu Bapak Ibu sekalian adalah marketplace yang sampai hari ini masih di develop sebagai pasar alternatif tata niaga pertanian. Nah, sebelumnya saya mau menyampaikan pengantar bahwa Paktani Digital sampai hari ini sudah mengembangkan platform. Yang pertama itu berupa media informasi melalui website. Jadi di sini berfungsi untuk mengembangkan pasar, mengembangkan customer atau customer development prosesnya ada melalui website. Baru produk atau product development-nya ada melalui aplikasi. Kita juga ada mengembangkan media sosial yang tentunya berhubungan dengan dunia pertanian melalui Facebook, melalui Instagram, melalui Paktani Digital. Nah, selain marketplace tata niaga pertanian, Paktani Digital selama setengah tahun terakhir juga sudah menelurkan marketplace untuk belanja dapur, keperluan keluarga, keperluan ibu rumah tangga. Nah, jadi ini sejalan dengan kondisi pandemi corona di mana social distancing, ya, menjaga jarak, mengurangi aktivitas luar rumah atau outdoor sehingga ibu-ibu rumah tangga bisa belanja kebutuhan dapur melalui aplikasi. Jadi namanya 3T. Jadi ini produknya bernama 3T, brandnya 3T. Jadi ini hasil dari kreasi Paktani Digital sendiri dan sudah beroperasi di 7 kabupaten kota dalam tempo 6 bulan terakhir. Nah, jadi apa yang mau disampaikan di sini bahwa Paktani Digital sebenarnya menginisiasi solusi untuk memecahkan masalah dari hulu pertanian sampai ke middle. Selanjutnya 3T adalah memecahkan masalah dari middle sampai ke hilir. Karena rantai tata niaga pertanian itu sangat panjang, Bapak Ibu sekalian, para audiens seminar ini. Jadi memang kita enggak bisa menginisiasi solusi yang sifatnya terintegrated, holistik, dari hulu ke hilir, from end to end. ya itu pekerjaan yang sangat sulit, sehingga dalam hal ini kita berstrategi untuk memecahkan dari M1 ke hulu, dari M2 ke hilir. Itulah Pak Tani Digital, itulah Tigata. Nah, karena saya adalah founder juga dari inkubator startup, jadi terbiasa berbicara di tahap awal mengenai problem. Tentunya khusus untuk Indonesia, kita ketahui bahwa petani berusia di bawah 35 tahun atau petani muda itu menurut data tinggal 4%, dan alih fungsi lahan pertanian itu berlangsung secara masif, sehingga kita kehilangan kurang lebih 500.000 ton beras, atau apa ya, decrease production dari beras itu 500.000 ton per tahun. Yang tadinya sektor pertanian berkontribusi ke PDB itu sekitar 21% di tahun 1991, di tahun 2017 tinggal 13% dan terus menurun. Masalah-masalah kita luar biasa seriusnya, Bapak Ibu, ya, para audiens sekalian, bahwa petani di usia di atas 34 tahun itu 87%. Kita kehilangan petani, 500.000 petani setiap tahun, ya, reduce minus 2% per tahun. Baru petani yang memiliki lahan di bawah 0,5 hektar juga lebih dari 50%. Baru nilai tukar produksi atau pertanian kita itu justru mendekatkan petani ke batas ambang kesejahteraan. Jadi wajar saja di sini bahwa menjadi petani maaf, gangguan moderator.
Suaranya putus-putus, Pak.
Oke.
Sekarang sudah biasa, Pak. Silakan dilanjutkan, Pak.
Nah, bahwa kami melihat bahwa lokomotif, kalau kita ibaratkan ini adalah kereta api masalah, kami melihat bahwa lokomotif dari masalah ini ada di masalah manajemen, terutama di manajemen pemasaran, khususnya lagi di manajemen pemasaran digital. Dan di pemasaran ini tentunya menimbulkan beberapa macam masalah turunan bagi petani yang menjadi masalah klasik selama ini, bahwa petani selalu berhadapan dengan rendahnya harga komoditi. Posisi tawar petani, bargain position petani juga sangat lemah. Minimnya akses ke supplier. Tentunya juga minimnya akses ke transportasi logistik, ya, minimnya akses pembiayaan, sehingga kurangnya kolaborasi antara stakeholder pertanian. Nah, itu adalah masalah-masalah yang membuat kami terdorong mengeksekusi inisiasi solusi ini, bahwa digitalisasi di Indonesia ternyata makin hari data menunjukkan optimisme yang cukup menjanjikan, karena pengguna internet di Indonesia itu sudah lebih dari 50% penduduk Indonesia di data 2020. Dan rata-rata pengguna internet juga sudah 3 jam per hari, khususnya untuk media sosial bahkan sudah di atas 4 jam. Penetrasi internet di daerah rural atau pedesaan atau pinggiran bahkan di data 2020 itu sudah 51%. Dan yang sangat luar biasa bahwa pertumbuhan pengguna internet 10 tahun terakhir lebih dari 10 juta pengguna internet baru setiap tahun. Nah, artinya jika tadi kita berbicara tentang pasar offline, tentunya pasar online juga menjadi satu keniscayaan, satu tuntutan, satu keharusan dari beberapa tahun yang lalu hingga ke masa mendatang. Dan apa yang menjadi dorongan bagi kami tentunya karena startup agritech ternyata mulai berkembang ya, khususnya di Indonesia. Mungkin audiens yang milenial, yang mahasiswa pernah mendengar Agromaret, iGrow, Gropal, Regopantes, TaniHub, Crowder, dan segala macam. Tentunya ini menjadi pendorong bagi kami, Pak Tani Digital, untuk mengeksekusi model marketplace yang memang belum banyak di Indonesia yang menjadi pionirnya. Sehingga solusi yang kami hadirkan seperti pembukaan di awal, kita mengembangkan satu marketplace yang sifatnya dari hulu ke middle. Yang kedua, kita mengembangkan Tigata yang sifatnya dari middle sampai ke hilir. Jadi inilah dia solusi semacam pengantar untuk Bapak-Ibu para audiens sekalian. Nah, yang kami lakukan salah satunya melalui media media informasi pertanian, saat ini kita sudah peringkat Alexanya itu sudah sekitar 2000-an dengan jumlah pengunjung baru rata-rata 300 ribu pembaca baru setiap bulan dengan total unique user itu sudah mencapai 5 juta unique user. Nah, progres yang kita dapat apalagi di masa pandemi ini ternyata keingintahuan banyak user akan konten-konten pertanian itu makin meningkat, luar biasa. Ya. Jadi sampai hari ini sebenarnya di Desember 2020 ya, sekarang posisi kita unique usernya itu ada 3 juta dan kita prediksi nanti di akhir 2020 nanti ada 3,5 juta unique user. Itu untuk media website. Nah, untuk aplikasinya kita baru punya sekitar 70 ribu penginstal di per tanggal hari ini ya. Dan diharapkan nanti 80 ribu pengguna aplikasi marketplace Pak Tani Digital di akhir Desember 2020 ini. Nah, jadi melalui marketplace ini segala sektor yang menyangkut pertanian seperti petani beriklankan mengiklankan komoditi tanamannya, mereka mencari alat mesin pertanian bahan, mencari benih, mencari pupuk. Demikian juga untuk perkebunan organik dan sebagainya, mereka bisa beriklan dan mencari supplier atau stakeholder bidang pertanian lainnya. Nah, ini sepintas kami tunjukkan model dari aplikasi yang sedang kami kembangkan. Nah, jadi Bapak Ibu para audiens sekalian bisa melihat bahwa di sini banyak stakeholder beriklan mulai dari industri hingga petani bahkan ibu rumah tangga juga. Nah, jadi inilah dia model aplikasi yang kita kembangkan karena kita melihat berbagai macam masalah di bidang pertanian, akhirnya kita mengembangkan pasar digital pertanian tersebut dengan kurang lebih ya fitur-fiturnya ada pasar petani, pasar supplier, dan sebagainya. Nah, mungkin bagi Bapak-Ibu para audiens sekalian nanti yang sempat membuka ya website kami, kurang lebih ini tampilannya. Dan kita selalu juga berusaha mengedukasi petani agar jauh hari sebelum panen mereka menginformasikan atau mengiklankan komoditi pertaniannya. Kami sangat yakin bahwa salah satu upaya untuk memecahkan masalah petani, misalnya masalah kepastian harga atau fluktuasi harga adalah mengembangkan big data pasar digital pertanian. Jadi kedepannya memang petani menanam bukan berdasarkan intuisi, berdasarkan feeling, ya, tapi berdasarkan data-data yang terlebih dahulu didapat dari pasar. Jadi bukan production based, tapi consumption based. Nah, kita juga menghimbau agar para petani mereka bersedia untuk rutin berbagi info harga jual komoditi mereka, agar info harga ini juga bisa menjadi semacam tolak ukur, semacam benchmarking bagi petani-petani atau pelaku-pelaku bisnis lainnya di seluruh Indonesia. Dan ini bisa dilihat bahwa selama lebih, sekarang sudah 2 tahun Pak Tani Digital, kita sudah punya konten kurang lebih 3.000-an artikel yang dikontribusi terutama 70% oleh mahasiswa-mahasiswa pertanian di seluruh Indonesia. Kami sangat beruntung karena memang yang mengembangkan Pak Tani Digital ini milenial Dan di tim kita itu lebih dari 50% itu mahasiswa. Nah, jadi yang menelurkan juga Tigata juga lebih dari 50% mahasiswa. Jadi kami percaya bahwa pertanian di masa-masa beberapa tahun ke depan itu memang di tangan orang-orang muda, di tangan milenial. Nah, kita juga membuat konten-konten ya tentang perkebunan, peternakan, dan perikanan. Oke, kita juga mengadakan acara Ghost to Campus untuk mengedukasi mahasiswa. Karena kami pernah punya pengalaman setengah tahun mengedukasi petani, kami gagal. Karena memang petani dengan teknologi itu gap-nya lumayan jauh. Makanya kita mulai dari yang terdekat, yang tercepat, ya mahasiswa-mahasiswa pertanian, dan kita lumayan rutin mengadakan event Ghost to Campus. Dan juga kita terlibat di beberapa-beberapa kegiatan pertanian dan seterusnya. Nah, yang menarik bahwa di tengah perjalanannya Pak Tani Digital itu menelurkan Tigata. Dia 11 aplikasi dibuat Pak Tani Digital, ya, yang rencana 17 aplikasi di tahun 2020 ini yang sudah beroperasi di 7 kabupaten kota, ya, di Jakarta juga sudah ada, di Batam, di Pekanbaru, dan seterusnya. Jadi ini menarik karena Tigata sendiri dikembangkan dia ekonomi berbasis komunitas. Ya, community ekonomi ekonomi berbasis komunitas dari suatu komunitas yang memang mereka sebenarnya punya potensi pasar yang luar biasa. Dan yang menariknya bahwa Tigata yang dikembangkan oleh Pak Tani Digital ini menggabungkan konsep Gojek, Sayur Box, dan Tokopedia. Jadi sekarang ini sudah punya 4 fitur, tapi di Desember ini ada 7 fitur dia kurang lebih. Nah, jadi ada mulai dari belanja dapur, kuliner, kirim antar barang, kios toko, ya, dan juga ada jasa-jasa bisnis yang lain, dan konsumen yang menjadi produsen juga ada. Ini agak unik fiturnya, nanti bisa kita tekan. Nah, kita juga sering mengadakan event-event, ya, termasuk seminar juga, termasuk workshop juga, termasuk juga kunjungan-kunjungan ke area-area sentra pertanian dan seterusnya. Nah, melalui inkubator startup kita juga mendorong ya milenial mahasiswa ini untuk ikut event-event khususnya pertanian. Bahkan kita sudah mendorong Pak Tani Digital untuk ikut event skala internasional seperti di Istanbul, Turki ini untuk World Cup Startup. Kita juga sering mengadakan lomba-lomba ya agar terutama orang-orang muda tertarik lebih lanjut, lebih jauh tentang masalah pertanian. Kita juga sudah menjadi media partner untuk 15 event nasional. Ini beberapa secara ringkas kita sampaikan. Kita juga mentoring untuk gerakan 1000 startup nasional. Pak Tani juga, digital juga termasuk di situ. Kita juga mengembangkan buletin. Sekarang ini sudah 10 edisi, ya 50 halaman gratis. Bapak Ibu audiens sekalian bisa download dari Pak Tani Digital. Dan di 1 Januari kita akan menerbitkan buletin pertanian 500 halaman. Ya, yang akan kita pasarkan mungkin dengan harga di bawah Rp2.000 ya file digitalnya. Nah, ini juga di YouTube-nya Bapak Ibu sekalian, media sosialnya boleh nanti dipantengin. Jadi Instagram kita sampai hari ini sudah ada sekitar 80.000 follower. Ya, target di akhir tahun 2020 ini ada 100.000 follower. Kita punya 3.600 postingan selama kurang lebih 1,5 tahun. Silahkan nanti dikunjungi dan di-follow. Oke, ini beberapa metrik yang sudah kita capai bahwa Pak Tani Digital itu dia sudah katakanlah dia usernya terbesarnya ada di beberapa kota, Jakarta, Medan, Bandung, Yogyakarta, dan Malang. Dan target strategi yang selama ini kita terapkan ternyata tepat karena user kita itu kebanyakan berusia di antara 18-24 ya dan 25-34 tahun. Baiklah, ini sepintas dari Pak Tani Digital. Ya, kita ini Tigata, hari ini sudah di satu kabupaten kota di Tanah Karo, asal kami di daerah Gunung Sinabung yang sampai hari ini masih erupsi. Ya, dia di satu kabupaten kota 4 bulan berjalan dia sudah melakukan kurang lebih 5.000 transaksi. Nah, jadi ibu-ibu rumah tangga sudah bisa mendapatkan ada sekitar 230 produk pertanian hingga sembako di dalamnya. Mereka bisa berbelanja dengan mudah. Fitur-fiturnya kurang lebih fitur standar sebagaimana yang ada di Gojek, di Tokopedia, atau di Sayurbox. Ini kurang lebih ada sekitar 4.000-an transaksi, Bapak-Ibu sekalian. Dan kita lagi mengembangkan big data, sehingga big data ini suatu saat bisa memang membantu petani di hulu hingga ibu rumah tangga di hilir. Ya, paling tidak itu aja, Bapak Moderator, sekilas slide presentasi kami, tapi pada intinya, selaku pengembang startup, selaku pemilik inkubator startup, ya, kita memang sangat berharap sekali dengan orang-orang muda yang memang bisa menjadi inisiator, apalagi memang berbicara tentang digitalisasi ini memang domainnya orang-orang muda. Jadi saya pikir ya selaku founder dari Pak Tani Digital, tidak perlu menunggu setelah tamat kuliah, ya bisa berkontribusi untuk lokal, bahkan untuk skala nasional. Ya bahkan sekarang dari bangku kuliah pun sudah bisa memulainya. Dan ini sudah kami buktikan di inkubator startup kami, dari sekitar 10 binaan kami, 5 dari binaan kami ini semua statusnya mahasiswa. Paling tidak ini sekilas presentasi dari kami, dan kami kembalikan lagi ke moderator. Terima kasih, moderator.
Terima kasih Pak Mahendra. Thank you so much for your presentation about Pak Tani Digital as a founder. So, rezeki juga bagi kita sebagai audiens dan pendengar langsung dipresentasikan oleh founder atau pendiri Pak Tani Digital. Terima kasih Pak Mahendra. Thank you so much for your presentation. Okay, ladies and gentlemen. So, the main point of the Pak Tani Digital was launching is about the management of the middle of the like the transaction between farmers and then also the marketplace. So the Pak Tani Digital is already been a solution also for the farmers and then for the all agriculture products that will give the chance for the farmers to take a big impact for their product like promote. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, because the Pak Tani Digital from Mr. Mahendra already presented his topic. So we continue for the second our guest lecturer today. Okay, our guest lecturer today for the second one is come from Philippines, and she is associate professor faculty of Agribusiness College of Economics and Management of Central Bicol State University of the Agriculture. Okay, from the International Awards and Mayor Accomplishments, Project Leader of the Virtual Farm Academic Joint Collaborative, Project of Asia Pacific Safe Network and Central Bicol State University of Agriculture. And the National Awards come from Silver Award for Best Paper at the 30th National Research Symposium of DA Bar held on November 7 until 8, 2018 and PICC, Manila, Philippines. And then the regional awards from Best Paper First at the Council of Deans of Graduate Education Regional Research Conference held on October 5 until 7, 2020. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome with the topic of Dr. Hanilin Aguilar Hidalgo, with developing creative agribusiness ideas in the new normal, for Mr. Miss Mam Hani, Dr. Hanilin Aguilar Hidalgo, time is yours.
Oh, kisa. Tama, let's go in.
Good day, everyone.
Okay, for committee, you should share screen for the presentation video. Okay, for the committee.
Satu.
Hanilin Hidalgo from the Central. Good day, everyone. My name is Hanilin Hidalgo from the Central Bicol State University of Agriculture, Philippines. We have been partners with Warmadewa University since 2017. And through your university, I was able to finally meet the beauty of Bali, Indonesia. Why did I mention this? Because my topic is about farm and tourism. How COVID-19 has changed the landscape of tourism and how I responded to it using creative agribusiness ideas. With my topic, I am wearing two hats. The hat of a university researcher as I study the post-COVID consumer outlook, and the hat of a would-be farm tourism operator as I respond to the trend in tourism in the new normal. I guess you would agree with me that this COVID-19 has pushed us to do things we never thought we could do. It has forced us to cross the line from the world we enjoyed before the pandemic to a new normal that we are now getting used to. From the social-physical engagements to face mask guarded and distance engagements. In our recently conducted study on consumer behavior in Southeast Asia, COVID-19 has created a new normal that urged us to study online, meet online, plant our food, buy and pay online, consume healthy options, prioritize basic necessities, save, and most of all, stay at home. But despite the adverse effects brought by this pandemic, our natural tendency is to adapt. From more than 500 young respondents we surveyed, we found three adaptation strategies common among them. I summarized them into three P's that are perceived to be shaping our characters in this time of pandemic. So here we go. The first P is prudent. People will reduce their demand for certain items after COVID-19, especially eating out, travel, clothes, and entertainment forms. Notably, the response on our question, what preparations will you do to cope up with such kind of crisis in the future? Majority of them answered that they will save more money and practice more healthy lifestyle, such as minimize vices, sleeping well, and resting. Approximately 73% described themselves as consumers who carefully plan their purchases after COVID-19 crisis, while only 13% of them would maintain the usual spending behavior as before this pandemic. Saving more and carefully purchasing make these people feel safer in their life when dealing with economic depression. The second P is being positive. Despite the pressures brought by the pandemic, the present generation are inclined to be more optimistic than pessimistic. At some point during the pandemic, more than 50% of the respondents felt distressed about the crisis. But overall majority, like 75% of them, are disposed to look on the bright side of COVID-19. Even though economic experts are worried about economic depression, these people developed optimistic attitude despite the inconveniences and losses brought by the virus. This positive disposition may be a driving force towards a quick recovery. The last P is prayerful. More than 50% of our respondents revealed that their devotion and spirituality has helped them cope up with this pandemic stress. I myself could attest to this because personally, we in the family became more prayerful. One of the most surprising response of the survey is the willingness of this present generation to invest in farming ventures, presumably to support their healthy lifestyle and mitigate accessibility to fresh food. This is a great opportunity for the agriculture sector and a boost in at least 3 of the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, and that is zero hunger, decent work, and economic growth, particularly for the youth. And of course, this responsible consumption and production. Let us further explore how the expected change in people's lifestyle could foster the agriculture sector. Pandemic lockdown and fear of contagion have forced people to grow their food in their homes. The empty shelves at the supermarkets caused by panic buying drove them to set up their homegrown food garden in both urban and rural areas. Subsequently, posts on home gardening have flooded social media to influence others to plant during the pandemic. In a random check during the pandemic's first wave peak on April 2020, of 30 Facebook posts with profiles from the region, one out of 3 users posted something about planting at home. Gardening has become a new habit to 33% of the consumers and plans to maintain even after the lockdown. Due to the fears brought by the pandemic, it would not be a surprise if the new normal will be growing food at home. While transport and labor disruptions still occur in large food companies, an alternative local food system could serve the current demand for food in the communities to shorten the supply chain. This may further encourage smallholders and farm families to intensify their production to supply the needs of their community. During the pandemic period, the local government in the Philippines supported the farmers and fisher folks by buying their products and as part of relief packs. During quarantine time, a massive rise in online shopping for essential items and financial transactions has been felt during the pandemic period, which became a convenient, faster and safer way to get things done, especially to first-time users. So this pandemic has become a compelling reason for the digitalization of farm products, which can now be purchased online. As businesses start to restructure their existing systems, food and agriculture supplies will be the major beneficiaries of a market system reform of the entire food industries. These young generations have the capability and eagerness to usher the digital and technologically savvy consumer group to the next level of farm-to-market connectivity. A shortened supply chain will definitely benefit the small producers. Tourism in Southeast Asia may not return to its usual state soon. Yet, people will still travel in areas with relatively low tourist numbers but not to high-risk destinations where they will have to undergo mandatory quarantine. Hence, a transformation from mass tourism to specialty markets may emerge as tourists look for options to veer away from the usual mainstream tourism. For most tourists, farms were just an alternative route or a side trip to a mainstream tourism site. This may be an opportune time for local tourists to nurture alternative destinations such as farm and ecotourism sites where social distancing can be observed. In the Philippines, the Department of Tourism is looking at farm tourism as the first tourism product to recover as more people will look for sites to reconnect with nature after a depressing quarantine period. There is no doubt that tourism and agriculture are the most affected sectors, with the former as the most vulnerable and the latter as the favored sector. I actually find this a good point to start developing an opportunity. So, the entrepreneur in me motivated me to combine these sectors so they could pull each other towards a quiet and steady recovery. They say that in order for a tourism site to be successful, it should first satisfy the basic elements popularly known as the four A's of tourism. And these are attraction, amenities, activities, and accessibility. And these elements or factors should be present in the type of tourism site that you want to develop. But when I assess my resources, what we only have is a farm. This farm. And how can a simple bear farm attract local tourists when we live in a rural community also surrounded by farms? We don't even have the basic attraction factor in the first place. And out of the four A's of tourism, we only have good accessibility because our farm is located near the road. And then I studied the trend in the new normal. Quarantine stress, so they need a new yet safe environment for a quick getaway. Urban gardening, finally, they are now appreciating agriculture than before. Healthy living, so they need a spice of wellness. And while the threat of COVID still exists, probably they want more privacy. These are the rest of the three A's in tourism that I needed in my farm. Attraction, the rice field view. Why not? It is a relaxing view. Activities, well, the wellness farm concept. Maybe it can work. and amenities. Well, let me do this part. And so, the concept of farm wellness was born. This was our pandemic baby. During lockdowns and when our neighbors do not have jobs, we employ the services to build our nesting place. And how did our prospective market responded? We haven't even formally launched the site yet, but we already got the attention of our local tourism officer and provincial tourism office. We also had several inquiries from friends for booking. But our story doesn't end there. Just recently, we were hit by the strongest typhoon that landed the planet Earth this year. Trees were devastated and 70% of them were badly damaged. And while the strongest typhoon is still ravaging its wind, three more typhoons are queuing the Philippines. For two consecutive weeks this November, a total of five typhoons visited our country, particularly our area. We just had a parade of typhoons. Whew. But even if we know that there will always be a typhoon, we still keep planting and improving our farms. Because that's what we should do when we fall down, to stand up again and continue living our lives and chasing our dreams. And every time we stand, we are smarter than our old self. So what lessons do I want to share here? Number one, COVID-19 is not just a virus. It is also an opportunity to recreate ideas and restructure systems, because probably it doesn't work anymore. Second, take advantage of the social media. Facebook and Instagram were my sources of inspirations. People post exciting photos on social media, and I used them to motivate me to do better than them. Third, no risk, no story. We have invested already a lot from this venture, and I am not saying that this is going to work, but I'm willing to take the risk because there is a lesson in every story. And lastly, it's important to save, because it is easier to act when you've got savings to back up your plan. Start saving when you can, because by the time you are ready to launch your idea, your wallet is prepared. Terima kasih, and I hope you learned something from my story. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Miss Dr. Hanilin Hidalgo, who comes from Central Vehicle State University, is already present about developing creative agribusiness ideas in the new normal. So the resume, the short resume of the presentation from Mom Hani is about COVID-19 is not a reason that we are not productive, but COVID-19 is the line that we must to cross the line to the new normal, new life, and new strategy to grow up our life. And the life comes from the agriculture who will help the tourism, because agriculture and tourism has a big relation among us. So the takeaways from the COVID-19, COVID-19 is the opportunity, and then also take advantage of the social media. And then also COVID-19, no risk, no story, no lesson. And then save yourself, save your family. Okay, thank you so much for Mom Honey, and then our discussion session will be held on the last after our third guest lecturer will present his material for us for today. So he is the education is PhD chemistry, King's College London, United Kingdom, 1977, and BSc University Malaya, Malaysia, in 1973, and then Exeter University with R.M.G. Roberts, 1984 and until 1985 sebagai research fellow di bawah Association of Commonwealth Universities. And then also as a visiting professor University of Canterbury, New Zealand and 2010 and visiting professor at University of Wellington, New Zealand. And then also the keynote and invited speaker from 2018 in the International Conference on Sustainable Agriculture, Food and Energy, Manila, SAFE, 2018, 20 until 21 October 2018. And then also in 2019, he is as a keynote or invited speaker in UMS Southern Network Joint Training, Basic Sensory Evaluation for Food and Non-Food Applications, 25 until 27th February 2019, University Malaysia of Sabah. And then with the topic for us today is growing table grapes in a limited area during the COVID-19 pandemic. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Professor Dr. Bohari Muhammad Yamin. For Professor Bohari, time is yours.
Ada?
Okay, for Prof. Bohari.
The line was cut off.
Yes, Prof. It's going well.
Okay, can we start now?
Sure, sir, Prof. Time is yours.
Okay, can you show me the presentation, the slides?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. slide presentation. Is it okay now?
Use Malay language.
Okay. Should I start now?
Okay. Okay.
Okay, I can start, yeah? Now,
sir, you should start now.
Okay. Should I start now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. First slide, please. Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning.
Waalaikumsalam.
And salam bahagia to everyone. So, first of all, my respect to the chairman of the webinar, the president of Warmadewa University, Wakil President, Rector, the deans, head of departments, para profesor, ladies and gentlemen. So, first of all, I would like to thank University Warmadewa. Next slide, please. Yeah. I remember first time I visited Warmadewa University, it's always seminar, not only libur, okay? So since then, I was given the opportunity to come down quite often for the seminar, specifically for Warmadewa University. Here are some pictures that I managed to get from my file. No, previous slide, please. Previous slide. Okay. So every time I came down to Warmadewa, I visited farm. The second picture was with Riza and Gamo. And this vegetable farm, organic vegetable farm. The two gentlemen and his wife on the left, I came to understand that they work in Malaysia for more than 10 years in organic farm. And they came back to Bali, started the organic farm. So that was an opportunity for me, being a chemist, to get involved in agricultural work. To me, chemistry is the center of science. I can easily adapt to all the discipline. But today, I'm going to speak about grapes. Yeah, I know everyone is eager to grow grapes. I also just started 4 months ago to grow grapes. So I just want to share my humble and experience growing grape for the first time. So I meet a lot of grape farmers. They are very well experienced, but they are not researchers. They are not doing a lot of work on writing up. So this is where I can get myself into the community work to write, to discuss, and to give opinions. So today I will speak about grapes. Okay. Now, when I started working on the grape as a researcher or academic, next slide, please. Next slide. Okay. We have to do some literature search, some background study. Previous slide, please. Previous slide. Okay, it is about food industry. So food industry is a very important commodity. So Malaysia have two category of fruits. The first one, they call it main fruit. There are shown in the middle picture.
Sekarang,
different fruits are like durian, bananas, pineapples. These are almost commodity. The government have given attention on these main fruits, but Malaysia still imported mangoes from many countries, Thailand in particular. On the left, everybody knows which is durian. Durian now is almost becoming commodities. I mean, the big markets is in China. Malaysia and Thailand are the one who major exporter of durian. And if you go to Beijing and you tell them I'm from Malaysia, they will call you Musang King. So Musang King has a big impact on China market of durian. This was after the exhibition in Bangkok, where our Malaysian delegate brought Musang King, plus dishes, pao, all kind of food and cakes containing Musang King. The public there were willing to wait for 4 hours just to have a taste on the foods consisting of Musang King flavor. That, I think the Thai delegate was a bit disappointed because they never thought of doing that. Okay, that's yeah, the second fruit which I want to show you is the pumpkin. Pumpkin is not a fruit, but it's a kind of vegetable which I grow around my house. The seed, I got it from Bandung. And the third one is the grape, okay? So Malaysia agriculture, income from agriculture is about 80%, 8.1% of GDP. That is about 89.5 billion ringgit. But we import fruit is more than 3 million ringgit fruit. So grapes and some of these fruits are classified in others, not the main fruits, okay? So it's interesting to see the grapes, the dates, tamar, and figs, zaitun, are mentioned in Quran. And pumpkin was eaten by the prophet. So all the food eaten by the prophet Muhammad is called prophetic fruit. That is, I think, why a grape become very important to the Muslim people, and not only Muslim, for the whole world, in fact. But for us, grape has been considered the temperate fruit, not suitable for our country, which I think it was wrong to have that kind of assumption. Let we go and study the history of grape. Next slide, please. Next slide. Okay. Actually, the grapes was, the original grape was from the Middle East, the Egyptian, 400 BC. And the first wine manufacturing plant was developed by the Egypt in 2500 BC. But later on, it goes to the western part through Roman Empire. And nowadays, we all know major exporters of grapes are from the Italy, from the European, from the American, and also the Japanese. So it was originated from Middle East. Okay, so much about that little history. And before we proceed to grow grapes, let's see how is the market. I think we have listened to Hani and also the first speaker talking about digital Tani. It is our market. So the price of grapes, I'm sure the imported one, here is an example, is a Koyo grapes from Korea and Japan. It costs you 36 ringgit or almost 37 ringgit. Not 1 kg though, this is only about 200 gram. So it is quite expensive. On the other hand, now we have a lot of grape from Australia. I think there are plenty of grape at this atmosphere now. So they market it in ASEAN country. And the price you can see there is 12 ringgit for 1 kg. That's Australian grapes. In fact, you can buy 5 ringgit in the morning. In the afternoon, it go back to 8, 9, 10. So that is a variation of the grapes that you can buy from time to time. You can buy from the local market, the one sold in the streets, and also in the supermarket. So the price, good price, depend on the time. But on the whole, the price of grapes in Malaysia in the supermarket is quite expensive. Okay, next slide. Next slide, please. Okay, I've already talked about free industry and how a chemist to look point of view from a chemist on agriculture, which is about plant. We have to learn about plant in order to be knowledgeable farmers. We have to know about some anatomy of the grape plants, varieties, soil, fertilizer, growth system, disease, and finally is the quality of the fruit. Okay, next slide. Okay, as a chemist, the plant is considered as a chemical reactor. So a chemical reactor here comprises of the roots where all the nutrients are being absorbed into the roots. So we should know the nature of the roots, the type of the roots. And there are people who study about the absorption of nutrients by the roots. So absorption of the nutrients is very important to make sure that the plant can grow very well. And the nutrient, of course, will go to the stem, is another part of the reactor. And then it goes to the leaf. This is another reactor. We'll manufacture the fruit, the manufacture the nutrients, not nutrient given to the soil, nectar, the manufacture of the sugar. You know, in the leaf, the photosynthesis going on. Photosynthesis is a very simple reaction equation, but the mechanism is so complicated. But it produces sugar from carbon dioxide, water, and that's all to produce sugar, C, O, and H. And then the sugar then distributed to all parts of the plant, particularly at the fruit. Sugar is the main product of photosynthesis. But sugar is not the only one product, but there are other products. Phenol, riboflavin, vitamins. So that is the whole package of product produced by the plants, in particular here, the grapes. Okay, we have to understand also how the water being absorbed to the root, go to the phylum, and go to the leaf. So this is agricultural, I just mentioned, and I don't want to go very detailed on that subject. Okay, next slide, please. Next slide, okay. Photosynthesis, we learn from the school days. But mind you, the subject of photosynthesis reaction have been subjected to very detailed studies, how the CO2 absorbed into the leaf, how it's converted into sugar. There are so many steps involved. And we have development on the artificial photosynthesis. I know Professor Fukuzaki from Osaka and another colleague of mine from Korea has been working on artificial photosynthesis to understand. So photosynthesis is a very, very fast reaction within nanosecond, femtosecond. So you must have all the facilitators, all the tools to measure within the first time of the reaction involved radicals. Just to mention about photosynthesis, which is very important. For the farmers, they have to know photosynthesis because it is related to the nutrients, the pupo or the fertilizer given to the plants. Okay, next slide. Okay, so when I first started, we visited grape farm in Malaysia. There are grape farm in Indonesia. So I think the grape was brought to Indonesia by the Dutch Indian Company in 1682, in 1682, year 1682, 17th century, by the Dutch, and was grown in East Java, Probolinggo, Pasaranon, and in Bali, Beluleng, Bali. So you have a lot of farm to visit in Java, in Bali, also in Sumatra, in order to get more ideas to start growing. Yeah. So in Malaysia, it is good to grow grapes in a greenhouse. So on the left is a greenhouse. I don't have much money now to green my own greenhouse, but I have many friends to share with them. So the best time is always to harvest the grape. This is when I visited my friend who grew grapes. So the next step I did, next slide please. Okay, to grow my own grapes in the house. So I'm sure now every one of you interested. In the past, not many people interested because they got the assumption that grapes are not suitable for our weather. So after you visit your friend, you will find happy faces. The lady there grow grape from Tasmania. You can see on the left bottom, Jupiter. So the question when you start to grow is, what varieties you want to grow? You don't want to start with variety which will demoralize you. Difficult variety to grow, at the end of the plant will die and you get frustrated. Okay, in Indonesia, the criteria to grow grapes, number one, the grape is easy to grow and give fruits very frequently. That is the criteria. Second, the grape should be tasteful enough, meaning sweet. Number three is the size. Size is big enough, attractive enough. This is the criteria to grow grape. So in Malaysia, the first grape, the first variety, which is considered as the old type variety, is Isabella. Isabella is not sweet, but sour. Second is IAC, I think start from Portugal. And Alfonso. These are three varieties in Malaysia. When Malaysia started research on grapes carried out by University of Pertanian Malaysia in 1981, they started with seed from Thailand. I think Malaga or something like that. But the farmers, they started with Isabella, IAC, and Alfonso, okay? So the left one is Jupiter now. Jupiter is the famous now, okay? Because Jupiter satisfies the criteria. Sweet, easy to grow, very fast, very often you can get fruit, when you harvest, new fruit will come out. Very sweet, only size is a bit small. Okay, next slide. Next slide, please. Okay, yeah. Some people, they have big area in their house. They can build greenhouse, they can build roofing, we call it in Indonesia para-para. You can grow in the soil, okay? This is friend of mine in Perak, they grow in the ground, okay? Which is very, very good. It's always good to grow in the soil. And you can see the fruit there. And in the second picture in the bottom is Puan Yasmin in Negris Milan, also grow in the greenhouse, not using para-para, but using a trellis. So this is at the semi-commercial scale. Now, how about people like us want to grow in our housing area? Many of us stay in a single-story bungalow, semi-detached bank house, living house, apartment, flats. We have very limited space, okay? So we can also grow grape in a very limited space. Next slide. Okay, this is my house. Riza and many friends have come to my house. So in my house, on the right, there are some space. On the left, there are some space. At the back, there are some space. And my wife had just built a roof for the car. I can use the roof to grow my grapes. So I can easily design to grow about between 20 to 30 grapes plants around my house, okay? Of course, sometimes my wife not very happy because he grow flowers all the time, okay? Okay, next slide. Okay, first, as I mentioned, the varieties. So the first variety I chose is Jupiter on the left. As I said, Jupiter grew very easy to take care, can give you fruits very often, very frequent. And there are farmers who was successfully produced within 4 months, the grapes. But my advice is not so focused on the quickest way of getting grapes. It should be around 6 months, 8 months, but many grape variety will take 1 year, 2 years. So within a year will be a good time duration for harvesting grapes. We have to allow the grape tree to mature enough, big enough, not to force them to produce fruit in a very short time. So if you do that in the long term, your plant will not be at the optimum stage. You know, grape tree can last for 20 years, okay? So on the left is Jupiter. In the middle is Isabella. My Isabella is not the old one, which is sour. This is what we call Isabella Madu. It was grafted by sweet grapes into the Isabella. And mind you, Isabella is another grape which is very, very easy to grow, not much problem. And the third one is Alfonso Lavillet. Alfonso also very sweet, but manja, you have to take care. So if you have a lot of grains, then the growth of your Alfonso is affected. So grape plant is sensitive to sudden change of weather. So if you want to grow grape, I recommend you these three varieties: Jupiter, Isabella, Alfonso. Once you experience to grow, later on, you can go for other varieties. Okay, that's varieties. Next slide, please. Next slide. Okay, how do you get these varieties? Well, here we can buy from the farmers. There are many farmers also in Indonesia, Philippines, Thailand. They sow it. They grow in the polybag. Depending on the size, the price will depend on the size. Jupiter, some sold at the price 140 ringgit, 80 ringgit. If you want to save money, you can buy cutting and propagate by yourself. Then you can experience how easy, how difficult it is. Also in Indonesia, the price, although affordable, but still I think it's quite expensive. If you want to start, semi-commercial, you have to discuss about the price. So that, and they make good money from selling this, I call it baby grapes. Okay, next slide. Now, the second is a medium of growth. You know, in Malaysia, the soil is important topic, as well as Indonesia. The pH of Malaysian soil is acidic, between 4 to 5. Indonesia soil is, I think, alluvial, and soil is very much fertile, but still you have to check the pH of the soil. For grape, the pH should be between 6 to 7. It is recommended that the soil, the medium for growing grapes, should follow the criteria. It is loose, have space, spores for the air, and also nutrients, and to keep the air and water capacity. This can be obtained by mixing topsoil and the cocoa peat, rice husk, and you can see on the right some of different type of compost. So all these are mixed and found suitable for growing grapes. Even if you grow in the soil, you have normally make holes and then you put in this mixture of compost, and for to improve the pH, you add dolomite or lime to the soil. That is soil part, okay? On the left, you can see the root of the grapes. After 20 years, the root can be as big, can be as taller than ourselves. Okay, that is medium. Next slide. Fertilizer, okay? Fertilizer is a very interesting subject to me. In the old days, stone time, they don't use fertilizers. There is no agrochemical company during that time. They just grow plant, the plant grow very well. This is because the soil have a very good biology. There are nematodes, there are fungi, bacteria, all kind of microorganisms that provide the fertilizer for the plant to grow. But over time, all these good nutrients were consumed. In addition, the plant become no longer fertile or no longer growing as one would expect it. So the modern agriculture has come out with modern fertilizers. So how do we know that the plant need nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium? So that people came up with the fertilizer NPK. Most farmers know NPK. Maybe some of them do not know what exactly NP and K. So the nitrogen, the phosphorus, and the potassium, these were known from the elemental analysis of the plant tissue. So when they analyzed the plant tissue, they found major compound there is nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. Therefore, they came out with the idea of making fertilizer or pupo containing nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium. In the biological system, you all learn about nitrogen cycle, phosphorus cycles. They're all from the biological cycles. Now, the cycle is not good enough to provide to the plants. We have to use fertilizers. So what are the sources for this NPK? So the sources of NPK come from inorganic materials. So sodium nitrate, for example, organic synthetic, which is urea, contain nitrogen and carbonyl. Phosphate rock, potassium nitrate. So they're all elements. So you have two components, microelement NPK, and microelements, the trace element, magnesium, zinc, cobalt, nickel. These are all inorganic fertilizer. Very, very effective. Fertigation technique using these fertilizers. You can mix all these inorganic material at once. So you split into two, we call it A and B. So your A, B fertilizers are inorganic fertilizers. Over time, this inorganic accumulation in soil will become toxin to the plants, to the animals. And your soil become very, very hard. People getting worried about agrochemical fertilizers. So next slide, please. So people go back to the traditional, but they call it organic farming, okay? So now we are introduced to organic fertilizers, okay? So organic fertilizers, meaning, yes, please go up. So, okay, meaning no metal, no inorganic material, no magnesium, no, but you still need nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. So you can get nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium from the nitrogen cycle, from the phosphorus cycles. So you have compost, you have bokashi. So the right picture was taken when we visited Chiang Mai University, organized by our SAFE network. They degraded the waste vegetable, or they fermented the waste vegetable using bacteria. After 3 weeks or so, they have some acid liquid, which is collected, and the degraded material will be processed to come up with organic compost. We can do our own compost from cow dung, like I am, from the goat, the cow hair. So we can do this all by ourselves. If you buy, you can buy organic compost in the market and you will know the price. For example, like in Malaysia, you can buy this fertilizer called Milagro. This is basically from Thai ayam. They said they use cow dung or Thai ayam from the egg chicken, not the daging chicken. And the price there is 88 ringgit. This is the offer price, you know. So if you grow 300 or 1,000 plants, grape plant, this is very costly. So you have to do some cost effective when you start expanding or scale up your farming activities. Okay, so now I'm sure from Warmadewa, you are also doing compost organic plants. So you can start your organic, what's wrong? Something is wrong here. Okay, you start growing or making your own organic fertilizer. Next slide. Well, this is another example, vermicompost. In Malaysia, we have a lot of waste from the mushroom industry. I'm sure in Indonesia, Philippines, and Thailand as well. So this is the waste from mushroom industry. They use worm, okay, to do the degradation work. This is in Denkel, not very far from my house. Unfortunately, my wife doesn't like the worms, but I like the worm. What they do is they mix the worm, added the worm into the mushroom waste, and leave it for about 1 month. At the end, we will see the wooden mushroom waste converted into a compost, small size, and then you seize it, you seize it to different size, you end up with beautiful, nice smell of vermicompost, which is very good for growing. I am not testing this vermicompost for the grape, growing grape, yeah? Okay, that is as far as fertilizers are concerned. Next slide, please. Next slide. Okay, just to show you, Jupiter grape can grow very easily. So if your grape grow very, very slow, then you have to check your fertilizers, your pH of the soil must respond to the growth. Okay, next slide. Okay, Jupiter, some Jupiter have seed, but some are without seeds, okay, seedless Jupiter. Okay, once you grow the grape will grow and will crawl all direction. So, well, some people just leave the grow, leave the plant grow as they like, and they will give you fruit eventually. The problem is you do not know when your plant will bear flowers and fruit. Some of my friend grow up to 3 years, nothing happened. So I help them by doing a cutting and pruning. Maybe 1-2 weeks later, they will see the grape. So you have to train the grape to grow in a systematic manner. So there are many models of growth. You can go through the YouTube, you can Google, but as beginners, sometimes you can get confused, okay? So to me, I would like to suggest one or two model of train the grapes, okay? Next slide. Next slide. Okay. So this is one model. If you have a grape tree, the first stem, this is called a primer, or primary stem, batang utama. In some cases, you have two branches. In some cases, you have only one stem, yeah? So one stem means single cordon. Two stem means you have two cordon. This one cordon, this another cordon. So I will stick to the terminology, cordon, primary stem, the cordon is a secondary stem, and some stem will come out from the secondary, we call the tertiary stem, tertiary. The fruit will be at the tertiary. So when you grow grapes, make sure you follow the primary, the secondary, and the tertiary. But there are other models, they use them spurs, but for beginners, I think we stick to the term primary, secondary, tertiary. Tertiary will bear the fruit. So we have to monitor the growth of this primary, secondary, tertiary. Next slide.
Sorry, Prof, for disturb your presentation. Your time, just 5 minutes more.
Okay, I'll go very fast. So this another picture. Yeah. Your secondary, and it's your tertiary, and the tertiary will give you flowers. Next slide. This another example, a good growth. Secondary, tertiary. Okay, next slide. This is the successful grape growth in an apartment. So you can grow your grape in the apartment. You stay in the flat. You can see secondary, tertiary, and the fruit is on the tertiary. Next slide. Next slide. Okay, when you start harvesting your grape, you can remove all the leaves and let the berries on the tree. Okay, next slide. Next slide. Okay, this is a system using para-para. So you let the tree grow on the para-para. This is the leaf from different variety. You can recognize the variety from the leaf, but sometimes it's difficult because they look sometimes look the same. Next slide. Next slide. Okay, next slide. Next slide. Okay, this is something you have to take care. So as far as disease is concerned, previous slide. So the philosophy is better prevention than cure. So on the right is a yellow rust, which is very, very common, especially during the raining season. So you have to spray your grapes almost every week. Either you're using the normal fungicide or organic fungicide. The insect here, not very common in my plant, but the yellow, yes, having this problem. So what I did, I just cut the leaves and throw away when I spray every week. Okay, next slide. Next slide. Okay, this is another insect. Okay, common insect. And also effect on the roots. Next slide. Next slide. Okay, now pesticide. I know Riza, Dosen di Marumadewa, is working on Trichoderma to combat fungi. So we are working on Trichoderma now as a natural fungicide to combat yellow rust. Okay, next slide. This is another beautiful grapes. Next slide. Now, quality and safety. People judge quality based on how sweet it is, how big it is. But being a chemist, we look the morphology inside the grapes. So you can see here, not like rice. Rice, you have a crystal of amylose and amylopectin. But the sugar in grapes are fructose, not amylose. So while you can see some crystal there, and you do some elemental analysis, this is Jupiter grapes grow in organic. I was surprised, high contents of silicon, potassium, iron, and calcium. Then I realized they use rice husk as a medium of growth. So the silicon must come from the rice husk. So it's very important to know what are the nutrients you provide in the medium. It is a Jupiter grown by using AB fertilizers, using co-pit as a medium. So I didn't find any silicon. I don't find any trace elements, but I'm not so convinced yet. I got to run more experiment because AB using inorganic compounds, I expected the presence of those compounds. So this is some aspect of quality control and food quality that I am now doing research on it. Next slide.
Okay, Prof. Sorry for you. This time.
I'm going to the last one. Next slide, please. Last, let's go to the last one.
Okay.
Okay, last one with the small picture. Next one. Okay. Previous one. This is the last one. Last one. A picture of a small tree. No. Go next one. Go to the bottom. Good bottom. Okay, never mind. Okay, I talk about no, not this one. Just a small plan. Selamat libur Sunday, something like that. The last slide. Terima kasih. Previous one. Go to the terima kasih slide. Down. Yeah. Terima kasih.
The last slide.
Only terima kasih. The word terima kasih. There.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Can you find that? Okay. I think time is short for me. I thank so much for your listen to my talk. I'm sure from now, I've given encouragement to many people to grow grapes and enjoy the grapes and more importantly is to grape offer you curiosity driven and to study about plant growth. Thank you very much.
You are absolutely welcome, Professor Buhari. Thank you so much also for your presentation and then also for your matri. It's so interesting because the limited of time that will give us a limited stage also to present our matri. So the main matri of Professor Buhari is say to us about chemistry is the center of science, right? Because the chemistry will discuss about the specific of the plant for how to grow the plant for in the middle of the pandemic. So with the limited area we plan to grow, especially in this presentation about grapes. And then also the analysis from and the criteria in Indonesia for grow the plants, especially for the grapes, it's so ability to grow in Indonesia for all the temperature and all the area. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, because Prof. Bari is already present about the matri, the last matri for us today. And then here we go for the last session is about discussion session. And this is the last session for us. Discussion, then we'll give you opportunity, a chance for give some response, even it's the questions or etc. It about depend on our presentation today. And then the first session I give for three person or three participants to give some question about all our matri. And it's better if some question to give to the all the guest lecturer materi. Okay, so masing-masing materi bisa diberikan satu pertanyaan, tetapi karena di kolom komentar sudah kita mengantongi beberapa pertanyaan, jadi saya akan membacakan pertanyaan pertama. Okay. For the first question I give for the participant, and then with introduce yourself first. Introduce yourself. Mute your microphone first. After mute your microphone, please introduce yourself and then give a question. Thank you. For the first participant.
Hello, moderator.
Okay,
so thank you for the chance that given to me. My name is Igede Karyase, agriculture student from Warmarewa University. Now, I want to ask one question for Mr. Mahendra, founder of Pak Tani Digital. Okay, for make a pass, I'm sorry, I'm use Indonesia. Moderator, apakah bisa mendengarkan suara saya?
Ya, yeah, oke, okay. Silakan dilanjutkan.
Mohon maaf, saya menggunakan bahasa Indonesia agar lebih cepat. Pak Mahendra. Halo, Pak Mahendra.
Oke, okay, silakan. Dek Gede Karyasa.
Silakan.
Saya memiliki satu pertanyaan, Pak. Nah, kebetulan Bapak menjadi founder di Pak Tani Digital. Nah, saya memiliki permasalahan di desa, khususnya di desa saya di Buleleng. Nah, permasalahan itu tentang harga di petani. Nah, banyak petani di desa saya itu mengeluh mengenai harga yang tidak maksimal didapatkan oleh petani, dari petani kepada konsumen itu. Nah, saya waktu ini sempat memikirkan sebuah ide bagaimana saya dapat memutus rantai perdagangan yang ada di masyarakat. Banyak dari petani yang, misalnya saya kasih satu contoh, Pak. Misalnya yang bermain harga di dalam pemasaran ini adalah tengkulak, Pak. Di mana tengkulak dia membeli, misalkan beli 1 kilo cabai dengan harga 5.000. Sedangkan tengkulak ini memainkan harga, dia bisa menjual dengan harga 15 ataupun 20.000 kepada konsumen. Nah, sempat juga yang saya memikirkan bagaimana saya bisa memutus rantai pemasaran yang berada di tengkulak ini, Pak. Nah, tadi Bapak menjelaskan tentang Pak Tani Digital, jadi saya tertarik untuk membuat sebuah teknologi ataupun aplikasi yang bisa menampung produk yang dihasilkan oleh petani dan bisa disalurkan kepada konsumen dengan harga yang maksimal, Pak. Mungkin Bapak bisa memberikan saran ataupun solusi agar saya bisa mengembangkan ide saya. Mungkin itu saja dari saya, Pak. Terima kasih, Pak.
So what the problem? Is that the signal or the access of the internet or what else about the digital implementation in your area? Apakah itu masalahnya tentang internet atau penggunaan internet di kalangan petani atau bagaimana permasalahan utamanya?
Untuk permasalahannya itu belum adanya teknologi yang dapat digunakan oleh petani untuk menyalurkan hasil pertanian yang dihasilkan oleh para petani.
Okay, thank you Gede Karyasa. Please save your question. And the question will answer by Mr. Mahendra at the last session. And then the second session for the second participant who want to give some question for for the second participant from a student from Pangan, Teknologi Pangan. Gek Ayu. Okay, I will read the comment from Gek Ayu. So the her question is about this. Seperti yang kita ketahui bersama, saat ini Indonesia sedang dihadapi oleh pandemi COVID-19 yang belum dan tidak diketahui kapan akan berakhir. Jika kondisi sekarang ini dihubungkan dengan pertanian Indonesia, maka pertanyaan saya, adakah upaya atau stimulus kepada para petani dan adakah jaminan pembelian atas produk atau komoditas yang dihasilkan? Karena di beberapa daerah, komoditas pertanian harganya cenderung menurun dan sepi permintaan sebab dari banyak restoran dan rumah makan yang ditutup atau mengurangi kapasitasnya dikarenakan pandemi. Sekian dan terima kasih. Okay. That's from the second participant. And then for the last participant, there is some question from Dr. Gede Pase for this
category.
The organic product has higher price than unorganic products. So their market is limited. The farmers want to their product can be sold in large volumes because they will can get a lot of profit. So how the farmers do to increase their market? Thanks for Professor Bohari. And then for Mam Hani, the question from Dr. Pasek Mangku also. During pandemic 19, the agriculture sector to be the popular sector and interesting to do, especially for the people who lost their jobs in tourism. Many people now do a job in agriculture, but we think that only for a while. It means that after the condition is normally, so they will back to first job in tourism. What will we do so the people who do the job in agriculture not move from new job as the farmer? Thank you.
Hello. Hello.
Okay. Mamani.
Yeah, I already answered it in chat, but I will still read it. I think tourism has been a very enticing job because, you know, in especially in Bali, Indonesia, your prime commodity there is tourism. But right now, I think people have begun appreciating agriculture more than before, and if they are already making money in agriculture, then I think they will have second thoughts in going back to tourism. But if tourism is their passion, then they can integrate farming into tourism. They can integrate agriculture into tourism. They can make new concepts, better ideas, new normal tourism concepts when things are going back to normal. But just remember that we always have risk. And it's not 100% assurance that when you go into a business, it's always successful. So there's always risk in it. And I've said in my presentation that risk is a good way to assess if you are really for that kind of business. And just like what I mentioned, if there's no risk, there's no story. And if there's no story, there's no lesson.
Okay. Thank you, madam, for the response. The main response of Mam Hani is about the if agriculture can make a more much money than another job. So she thinks that they will have second thoughts in going back to tourism. Thank you. And then the first question is about Patani Digital. Pak Mahendra, ada pertanyaan dari mahasiswa tentang teknologi ini. Karena kalau ngomong-ngomong soal teknologi ini, kebetulan kita juga saat 2018 kita mencoba menciptakan suatu teknologi juga, Pak Mahendra, di program kreativitas mahasiswa. Jadi ini adalah salah satu tempat bagi kita untuk memaksimalkan apa yang kita punya, ide yang kita punya. Tetapi saat itu betul-betul kelompok kami belum mengetahui juga, Pak, bagaimana cara membuat teknologi ini yang berbasis digital sehingga management as the main problem of the farmers and the product in market could be realized. Jadi bisa lebih ditekan harganya sehingga pendapatan petani lebih besar. Nah, inilah juga yang dihadapkan oleh Gede Karyasa tadi. Sebagai penanya, mungkin bisa disampaikan sedikit solusi, Pak, untuk hal ini. Terima kasih.
Terima kasih moderator Mr. Bonifacius.
Sama-sama, Pak.
Terima kasih Dek Gede Karyasa buat pertanyaannya bagaimana ya menangani fluktuasi harga. Ini sebenarnya persoalan klasik dari dulu hingga hari ini. Kenapa fluktuasi harga terjadi? Karena petani kita bercocok tanam production base, tidak berdasarkan consumer atau consumption base yang bermuara ke big data. Nah, jadi kita beruntung, kita sekarang hidup di era keterbukaan informasi, di mana era informasi ini memang membuka banyak hal, ya, kemudahan akses dan juga transparansi. Nah, jadi mau nggak mau, sama seperti visi Pak Tani Digital yang tadi ada 7 masalah yang dihadapi petani, salah satu fluktuasi harga, memang kita harus mengembangkan pasar alternatif selain pasar offline. Nah, kami punya pengalaman bagaimana mengedukasi petani dalam 6 bulan ternyata gagal. Karena data tadi menunjukkan bahwa 85% lebih petani kita berusia tua. Sementara yang berusia muda kurang lebih sekitar 15%. Tetapi ada berita baiknya bahwa penetrasi internet di daerah rural, pedesaan, pinggiran itu sudah mencapai lebih dari 50% di tahun 2020. Ya, di desa-desa dimanapun sekarang kita tidak sulit melihat orang-orang tua dan orang muda itu memang sudah punya gadget. Jadi tinggal bagaimana kita menghadirkan pasar digital ke dalam gadget mereka, serta mengedukasi terutama orang-orang muda di pedesaan, dan mahasiswa-mahasiswa pertanian seperti adik ini semua. Ya. Jadi ini sebenarnya tidak butuh waktu lama lagi. Jadi kami selaku inisiator untuk pasar digital pertanian ini salah satunya di Indonesia, yakin tidak sampai 2 tahun yang akan datang, fluktuasi harga ini mulai terpecahkan. Sekarang pun kita sudah melihat benih-benih solusi itu di Pak Tani Digital sendiri. Apalagi kita juga sudah mengembangkan 3T di 7 kabupaten kota dalam 6 bulan, bagaimana menjembatani dari petani hingga ibu rumah tangga. Nah, Gede Karyasa, kami Pak Tani Digital ini sebenarnya membuka kesempatan untuk kerjasama, untuk kolaborasi, baik secara sosial, baik secara sosial bisnis, baik secara bisnis murni, ya. Jadi kita juga rindu bahwa sistem kita ini diimplementasikan di kampus, ya, di community atau society, ya, untuk mengembangkan ekonomi berbasis komunitas. Nah, saya juga tertarik tadi dari apa yang disampaikan Dr. Hanilin tentang bagaimana sebenarnya, ya, mungkin agroturism, ya, di tengah situasi stres yang luar biasa karena pandemi ini, dan kami memutuskan besok sekeluarga dengan 3 anak-anak kecil kami untuk jalan darat nyetir mobil sampai ke Lombok dan akan stay di Bali kurang lebih.
Wow. Ya. Bisa singgah di Bali, Pak, Pak Mahendra.
Mungkin nanti kita bisa ketemu, karena saya kepingin sekali menghibahkan sistem ini juga secara sosial, baik untuk komunitas, baik untuk society, bahkan untuk kampus sendiri, agar mahasiswa atau sivitas akademisi itu belajar bagaimana menjadi agropreneur dengan mengembangkan pasar digital pertanian ini. Dan kita tidak muluk-muluk bakal memutus rantai, karena tengkulak, ya, agen-agen itu adalah bagian dari rantai ekonomi. Kita sulit untuk katakanlah memotong mereka. Yang bisa kita lakukan saat ini adalah membatasi ruang gerak mereka dengan membangun pasar online yang lebih terbuka, lebih mudah diakses, dan lebih transparan. Jadi justru lokomotifnya adalah teknologi IT, dan jangan lupa kita tidak bisa berharap dengan petani-petani tua. Justru kita berharap yang menjadi pemain-pemain utamanya di sini adalah orang-orang muda, milenial, bahkan mahasiswa pertanian. Saya begitu yakin, bahkan sudah membuktikan dari 10 orang di Pak Tani Digital, 5 orang mahasiswa. Paling tidak ini mungkin penjelasannya akan panjang lebar, Dek Gede Karyasa, mungkin nanti kita bisa bagaimana caranya ketemu untuk mendiskusikan apa yang bisa Pak Tani Digital bantu untuk persoalan pertanian, tidak hanya di daerah Gede Karyasa, juga di mana, ya, audiens ini juga berada. Okay. Boleh secara sosial, boleh secara sosial bisnis, bahkan boleh secara bisnis. Terima kasih moderator, Mr. Badar Fasir.
Terima kasih, Pak Mahendra. Berarti intinya adalah kerjasama antara founder Pak Tani Digital dan juga mahasiswa sebagai pelaksana di lapangan, dan intinya untuk mempermudah pelaksanaan atau operasian Pak Tani Digital di kalangan petani, yaitu dengan sosialisasi lanjutan atau berjenjang yang diperankan oleh mahasiswa langsung sebagai subjek untuk melakukan sosialisasi ini. Sehingga ternyata sosialisasi yang dimaksud berarti berhubung sama kegiatan Tridharma perguruan tinggi, yaitu salah satunya tentang pengabdian kepada masyarakat. Berarti menjadi salah satu stimulus juga bagi kita ya Pak ya, dan berhubungan dengan pertanyaan dari Gek tadi tentang bagaimana, apakah ada stimulus atau jaminan pembelian atau produk atau komoditas yang dihasilkan oleh petani, berarti bisa juga daripada peran dari digital marketing yang diciptakan oleh Pak Mahendra lewat Petani Digital ini ya Pak ya. Berarti penting juga untuk disosialisasikan kepada masyarakat di skala daerah, apalagi menurut Pak Mahendra tadi sudah 50% daya akses internet yang merambah sampai di daerah pedesaan. Jadi ini selain memanfaatkan teknologi internet bisa menghasilkan atau meningkatkan bagi para petani. Terima kasih Pak Mahendra untuk jawabannya. Lalu yang ketiga, pertanyaan ketiga tentang pupuk organik dan anorganik kepada Pak Prof. Bahari. Jadi pertanyaannya, so do organic fertilizer is more than higher the price of organic fertilizer than unorganic. So how to optimize or utilization in organic fertilizer with the higher or the price? So okay. For Prof. Bahari, time is yours to respond to these questions, please.
Okay. Organic, the word organic now become expensive. This is because the arts of marketing. Those who work in the marketing area, their creativity is making money. Organic to me is anything that being produced, for example, like agricultural products, they do not use metallic or inorganic salt in their system. So for organic rice, mainly using natural fertilizers, if you do some calculation, it will be cheaper than conventional rice. But it is being sold at a very high price. This will be good for the petani, good for the farmers, good for the businessmen. But the question is, does really the profit go to the petani, go to the farmers, or to the customers? Anything organic now sounds very expensive. Organic donut, organic curry puff, anything organic. So when it comes to marketing, the word organic from chemistry point of view, to me, if it's going to be expensive, okay, it should be cheaper. How to make it, how to rationalize things? Then the idea of this internet farming, more knowledge, more information about what organic products are, to educate the people. Just an example, Merck. No fat Merck is more expensive than the ordinary Merck. Now people know how to make milk with less cholesterol. They just dilute it with water. But why should it be more expensive? Now the public know they dilute in water, it should be much cheaper. Now, if you buy milk with less cholesterol, less fat, the price is cheap. Now, how can we educate the public to know that organic product should be cheaper than conventional product? For an economist, it's a simple theory of supply and demand. If the supply is small, demand is high, the price is going up. So I think now it is our generation, the internet generation, sincerely think about balancing the profit. The farmers will enjoy it, the marketeers will enjoy it, and the customer will enjoy it. So I think we have an issue here, how to make organic product in the long term more cheaper than as conventional product. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much, Prof. Bahari. So that the about the price is about the marketing games inside the price of the organic or unorganic fertilizer.
Ini musuhku punya gitu ya. Dadah. Itu mau tanya Kak Wahyu ya.
Okay. For the next term, we give for 3 participants to give some question. And then in the comment below, we have from the Mr. Krishnawan Kalimutu, who want to give some question for Mr. Mahendra. For Mr. Krishnawan, time is yours.
Yeah. Terima kasih kesempatannya yang diberikan kepada saya. Good day everyone. My name is Krishnawan Kalimutu.
Good day.
Saya sekarang sebagai alumni Fakultas Pertanian dan saya juga sangat tertarik dengan bidang pembangunan pertanian ini, apalagi dengan sentuhan teknologi digital. Nah, beberapa yang studi lapangan yang saya pernah lakukan sebelumnya itu, saya melihat di mana seringnya tidak ada sinkronisasi baik itu antara pemerintah, petani, dan pasar yang dibutuhkan. Jadi untuk Bapak Mahendra, apakah petani digital nanti akan berkolaborasi juga dengan selain dengan petani atau pihak pengusaha, baik itu rakyat sipil sendiri, apakah juga akan melakukan kolaborasi dengan pihak pemerintah? Karena nyatanya di lapangan yang saya dapatkan itu, seringkali pemerintah itu tidak apa ya, entah bagaimana itu bantuan bibit itu terlalu banyak sehingga kapasitas lapangan apa kapasitasan itu lahan itu tidak memungkinkan untuk menanam itu semua. Waktu KKN saya ambil contoh aja di daerah sekitaran Badung itu paling banyak sekali dengan bantuan pemerintahnya. Yang pertama waktu dulu
okay, check. Mr. Krishna. Check, Mr. Krishna.
Ya, halo. Okay. Ya, maaf ada sedikit gangguan tadi jaringan. Jadinya saya lihat di daerah Badung, di mana pemerintahnya itu apa ya, terlalu banyak sekali bantuannya sehingga petani itu jadinya tinggal nanam-nanam saja. Sebagai contoh, itu ada beberapa lahan saya lihat, saya sudah temui langsung, itu ditanami oleh tanaman kakao. Kemudian diberikan bantuan durian, kemudian diberikan bantuan lagi manggis. Jadinya itu saya lihat itu banyak lahan itu ya seperti terbengkalai, tidak sesuai dengan prosedur penanaman di lapangan. Nah beralih karena saya juga dari Kabupaten Poso, saya melihat sendiri juga pemerintahnya 11-12. Jadinya entah bagaimana, mereka memberikan bantuan bibit durian, entah apa yang dikejar untuk Indonesia ini. Mereka memberikan bantuan itu bahkan untuk ribuan hektar luasnya. Dan saya juga terdaftar di sana, tiba-tiba diberikan bibit bantuan. Saya bilang sama orang tua saya, jangan diterima kalau sudah bibit itu sudah terlalu banyak sekali, sudah tidak sesuai dengan kebutuhan kita. Nah, nyatanya pemerintah kita itu masih seperti itu. Dan beberapa kasus juga waktu lonjakan cabai, pemerintah Jawa Timur juga pernah melakukan hal yang sama dengan menyuruh semua
Oke, cek.
Halo?
Halo, ya.
Halo?
Lanjutkan sedikit lagi.
Bisa didengar?
Bisa, bisa. Silakan, silakan dilanjutkan sedikit lagi.
Halo?
Ya, bisa dilanjutkan lagi.
Halo, bisa didengar? Ya. Jadinya melihat juga di Jawa Timur waktu itu, pemerintahnya itu menggenjot semua petani itu untuk memproduksi cabai. Alhasil harga itu benar-benar jatuh. Dan untuk komoditas lainnya, saya yakin untuk selain daerah yang saya ketahui, pasti banyak daerah di Indonesia juga ada hal yang seperti itu. Karena entah apa yang saya, waktu itu saya sempat tanya, kenapa ini bisa diberikan tanaman ini? Dengan alasan itu simpel. Di sini bagus untuk tanaman itu. Kemudian jangan-jangan yang sebelum-sebelumnya diberikan bantuan, itu juga mengatakan bahwa tempat itu cocok untuk ditanami gitu. Nah, apa sebenarnya dasarnya dia mereka mengatakan seperti itu? Saya tidak mau kalau umpamanya bantuan itu, saya ingin itu bantuan itu benar-benar spesifik dan memang itu ada integrasi antara baik itu pemerintah, pihak.
Oke, terima kasih Kak Krishna, Kak Krishnawan Kalimutu. Jadi langsung ke Pak Mahendra tentang digital marketing, Pak. Jadi ini apakah nanti Pak Tani Digital ini akan bekerja sama juga dengan pemerintah mengingat stok bibit yang ditemukan di lapangan itu terlampau besar, Pak? Itu, Pak. Itu yang pertama pertanyaan. Second question, we give to the second participant, Kevin. For Kevin, time is yours, Kevin. For some question.
Hey. Okay. Excuse me, suara bisa didengar?
Okay.
Okay.
You should ask. Time is yours.
Okay, thanks for the time. Okay. So, I have a few question here. So, the question is for all of the speakers. Jadi pertanyaannya ini buat ketiga pembicara. Jadi pertanyaannya itu adalah, have any of you ever started a fruit cultivation business? If so, I want to ask, what are the common mistakes that occur and how to prevent them? Jadi ada pernah nggak sih membuat suatu usaha menjual buah? Terus kalau pernah itu, apakah ada kesalahan-kesalahan umum yang pernah terjadi dan bagaimana cara mengatasinya? Nah, yang berikutnya, and do you have any advice about how a new fresh fruit supplier to find a customer, including distributor or a reseller? Is there any specific marketing or operating method to make this business keep developing? Apa suara bisa didengar?
Bisa, Putu Kevin, yeah. Tapi bisa diperjelas dan diperlambat sedikit.
Oh, okay, sorry.
Yeah.
Have any of you ever started a fruit cultivation business? If so, I want to ask, what are the common mistakes that occur and how to prevent them? The next question is, do you have any advice about how a new fresh fruit supplier to find a customer, including distributor or a reseller? Is there any specific marketing or operating methods to make this business keep developing? Thank you. Apa sudah jelas? Bisa dengar?
Oke. Okay. It's already?
Thank you.
Oke, okay, you're welcome. Thank you so much for Kevin. And then also for the last participant, for Mr. Adi Masaji.
Oke,
okay. Adi Masaji, time is yours.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Salam sejahtera bagi kita semua. Saya ingin bertanya kepada Pak Tani Digital, atas aplikasi Pak Tani Digital ini sangat bermanfaat untuk masa depan, untuk agribisnis Indonesia, seperti itu. Semasa pandemi ini, saya mencoba untuk menjelajahi pasar-pasar yang ada di Bali, maupun sekarang saya di Sulawesi untuk mengamati perkembangan pasar pertanian di Sulawesi juga, seperti itu. Yang menjadi problem sekarang di kalangan petani itu adalah harga yang sangat murah. dengan harga yang sangat murah itu disebabkan oleh minimnya daya beli masyarakat. Mungkin ada solusi dari Pak Tani Digital untuk minimnya daya beli masyarakat seperti itu. Terima kasih.
Daya beli masyarakat. Oke, terima kasih banyak Mr. Putu Adi, Mas Haji. Thank you so much for the question with the last term that we have today. The first stage I give for Mr. Mahendra again for digital marketing. Pak Mahendra, jadi ini ada pertanyaan dari Kak Krisna tentang pengadaan bibit yang terlalu banyak, sehingga apakah nanti Pak Tani Digital akan bekerja sama dengan pemerintah untuk meminimalisir hal tersebut? Silakan Pak Mahendra untuk merespon atau menjawab. Mr. Mahendra.
Oke, maaf. Terima kasih moderator. Terima kasih Dek Krisnawan. Elaborasi yang menjadi pertanyaan, sebenarnya Pak Tani Digital membuka kesempatan yang luas untuk berkolaborasi untuk seluruh stakeholder pertanian. Tetapi pada saat kita berbicara tentang teknologi, khususnya teknologi digital, teknologi yang katakanlah bakal datang dari masa depan, tidak semua yang bisa memahami. Jadi kita sudah menjajaki ke pemerintah, ke lembaga pendidikan, ke seluruh stakeholder yang lain, memang kita kesulitan untuk berkolaborasi. Karena memang apa yang menjadi konsep kita adalah customer base, ya, bukan production base. Dan kita sangat meyakini yang namanya big data, dan kedepannya teknologi blockchain akan mengambil peran yang sangat penting untuk segala aspek perkembangan, penanganan masalah, termasuk di bidang pertanian, termasuk di fluktuasi harga, dan segala macam. Apa yang mau saya sampaikan di sini, Dek Krisnawan, bahwa kebetulan saya adalah founder dari sebuah inkubator startup, dan mungkin sudut pandang kami dan cara kami mengeksekusi problem itu berbeda. Ya, itu tidak top to bottom, tapi kita bottom to top. Artinya, kita justru dengan segala keterbatasan sumber daya yang ada, berusaha untuk menginisiasi solusi. Kalau kita sudah bergantung ke banyak pihak, ke pemerintah, ke lembaga pendidikan tinggi, ke investor, ya, dan sebagaimana segalanya, tentu otonom kita itu akan makin rendah. Jadi kita di startup ini tidak mulu-mulu. Kita mengerjakan apa yang terdekat, apa yang tercepat. Nah, kebetulan domain kita banyak di teknologi, kita akan kerjakan dengan teknologi. Ya. Makanya cara terdekat yang kami tahu persis untuk mulai menginisiasi solusi terhadap masalah fluktuasi harga, termasuk sampai harga murah di tingkat petani ini, tidak ada cara lain terbaik selain membangun pasar alternatif. Selama ini pasar offline sudah ada, tentunya akan kita kembangkan pasar online.
Nah, berarti termasuk pertanyaan ketiga ya Pak Mahendra tentang ya daya beli di masyarakat yang tergolong kecil ya Pak ya.
Betul. Nah, waktu kita mengembangkan misalnya pasar digital pertanian, baik tadi saya ada juga sampaikan contoh Tigata. Bagaimana di tengah kelesuan daya beli ini, petani atau kelompok tani bisa punya peluang menjual langsung ke end user, itu adalah satu kreativitas yang menarik. Jadi kita butuh platform lain yang bisa menjembatani dari tengah sampai ke hilir sampai ke end user. Nah, jadi saya pikir kita yang muda-muda, yang milenial ini ya, ya kita akan coba kreativitas dari sini. Terus ini lagi yang perlu saya sampaikan ya, Mr. Bonifacius, bahwa kerjasama dengan Pak Tani Digital untuk seluruh stakeholder bukan semata hanya dengan brand Pak Tani Digital. Jadi kalau misalnya Bapak Ibu ya, para audiens sekalian punya community, punya society, kita akan bantu mengembangkan dengan brand Bapak Ibu sekalian gitu. Apalagi kita meyakini bahwa kompetitor dari ekonomi berbasis kapital di masa depan itu hanya satu, yaitu ekonomi berbasis community atau society. Dan kita sudah membuktikan itu di daerah letusan Gunung Sinabung, Tanah Karo. Kita mengembangkan suatu platform belanja dapur online dalam 5 bulan di satu kabupaten transaksinya itu sudah mencapai 5.000 transaksi di kota kecil. Nah, jadi ini menarik sekali. Jadi saya pikir untuk Dek Krisnawan dan juga Putu Kevin dan Putu Adi Mas Haji. Jadi memang kita harus concern mengembangkan pasar digital ini, apalagi memang ya domainnya digitalisasi ini kan memang orang-orang muda. Jadi mungkin saya sedikit melintir seperti apa yang disampaikan Profesor Bohari tadi, bahwa saya juga pengalaman menjual komoditi organik. Harganya mahal? Iya. Apakah semua petani bisa menjadi petani organik? Iya, enggak juga. Karena pasarnya memang terbatas, segmented, dan niche pasarnya. Nah, kita menemukan pembelinya itu dengan membangun konten. Customer development-nya itu tepat. Karena komoditi organik ini multi-benefit. Jadi informasi-informasi, konten edukasi, motivasi, inspirasi tentang organik ini harus sampai ke konsumen yang limited tersebut. Nah, untuk petani yang sukses mengembangkan komoditi organik, dia akan menjadi daya tarik untuk petani-petani lainnya. Kita nggak akan bisa memecahkan ratusan masalah pertanian dengan simultan. Tapi akan kita pecahkan menurut domain ya kita di mana kita masing-masing. Seperti Profesor Bohari di organik, tapi Dr. Hanilin dia di masalah ya mencakup agrowisata misalnya. Tadi saya tertarik juga dengan satu pertanyaan Dr. Gede Pase, apakah setelah berakhir corona ini, orang yang latah jadi petani nggak lagi jadi petani? Kan begitu ya?
Ya, betul-betul, Pak.
Ya, saya pikir kita mungkin tidak konsentrasi ke sana, kita konsentrasi ke petaninya. Petani bisa menciptakan nilai tambah dengan mengembangkan agroturism. Kita aja sekarang rindu gitu, anak-anak kita belajar bagaimana misalnya menanam jeruk, memanen jeruk, ya memanen ikan lele. Kita bersedia bayar untuk itu gitu. Dan kita juga melihat di sekitar lokasi perumahan kita, ada sawah-sawah yang disewa pengusaha, di mana petaninya tetap menanam padi, dan dia membangun jalan-jalan dari papan, di mana jalan-jalan tersebut ada turis yang datang dikutip bayaran dan bisa foto selfie di situ. Artinya kreativitas-kreativitas untuk petani juga akan bertumbuh dan berkembang ke depannya. Memang yang latah sampai kapanpun akan tetap latah. Tapi bagaimana petani ini menjadi lebih kreatif? Saya pikir perlu ya dampingan ya, tidak perlu mulu-mulu, mahasiswa lah mulai mendampingi petani. Nah, kita juga sebentar lagi akan punya program bagaimana satu mahasiswa mewakili 50 petani untuk go digital. Ya, jadi petani sedari kuliah, dia juga sudah belajar jadi agrotrader. Ya, paling tidak ini sedikit dulu sekedar bahan diskusi kita. Terima kasih, moderator.
Terima kasih Pak Mahendra atas jawabannya sangat singkat dan jelas. Saya pikir bisa menjawab semua pertanyaan yang diajukan di sesi terakhir ini for the last term. And then jadi kesimpulannya bahwa Pak Tani Digital terbuka ya Pak ya untuk semua stakeholder, untuk semua stakeholder yang mau bekerja sama. Hanya konsepnya bukan top to bottom, tapi bottom to top. Jadi sangat luar biasa bisa membantu dari kalangan bawah hingga mempengaruhi dari untuk area yang lebih besar, for large area around the world. Oke, for this term, is there any response from Prof. Bohari? If you have some response again for this question for the last term,
oke.
Okay. Tambahan cuma, untuk pertanyaan-pertanyaan ini, Pak Prof. Silakan Pak Prof.
Ya, nasihat saya pada mereka yang mau terlibat dalam digital tani, harus turun padang. Harus turun padang mean you should approach the petani. Approach the petani, the communities. So build up your own empire. Now, yang saya kurang senang, kebanyakan marketers ni, dia mau jadi bilioner dalam masa yang singkat. Bikin uang. Tapi pemikiran itu kita ubah sedikit. Supaya sekarang terbuka, to build up the business, you have to go and approach the community, the petani, trying to be fair in making profit, in helping the petani, supaya in the long term, petani juga enjoy. As mentioned Pak Mahendra tadi, persoalan pricing ini
masalah lama yang sudah bertahun-tahun. Hari ini tidak beres. Tidak beres kenapa? Kenapa? Pada pengen saya, marketias ini tidak jujur. Jadi petani digital ini boleh merupakan satu platform yang baru lah. Menjadi kompetitor kepada mereka, kepada bisnis yang lebih friendly. Okay. Itu pendengar saya.
Terakhir Pak Prof dari Kevin tentang memperjualbelikan buah ini Pak Prof. Mungkin ada masalah di sekitar usaha proses memperdagangkan buah. Jika ada masalah, kira-kira bagaimana solusi Pak Prof?
Oke.
Okay. Mungkin Pak Prof.
Kalau konteks anggur lah ya. Kalau konteks durian king tadi, itu di Beijing harganya gila-gila. Jadi sekarang orang Malaysia banyak menanam musang king. Karena harganya 100 kali lebih mahal daripada harga di Malaysia. Nah, anggur ini, kalau imported itu harganya mahal. Buahnya manis, buahnya enak. Oh, lokal terpaksa jual dengan harga yang mahal juga. Tetapi kalau tidak terlalu mahal, di harga itu dipermainkan di peringkat marketing, supermarket, lokal, farmer juga mengalami masalah. Jadi apa yang saya beri pandangan supaya attitude yang marketing ini untuk try to make profit as much as possible in a short term of time, itu harus diubah. Satu kegagalan yang kita lihat ialah dalam industri fix buah zaitun ya. Dulu buah zaitun untuk anak pokok, satu pokok RM200, RM100, mereka make a lot of money. Okay. After three years, farmers know how to propagate their fig. They don't buy anymore. Now, industry fig atau buah zaitun itu menurun. Sekarang anggur naik. Maka saya cadangkan jangan jual terlalu mahal. Jual pada harga yang affordable. Kalau anak anggur itu sekitar di Malaysia ini RM40. Mungkin dia beli dengan RM200. Kemudian dia tanam. Itu bisa menghasilkan sampai 1,000 batang. Jadi kalau dia jual pada harga yang dia beli untuk 1,000 batang, itu akan membuat profit yang sangat pantas. Tak ramai orang yang sanggup membelanja. Jadi harga itu harus harga yang friendly lah pada saya. Tidak semata-mata memikirkan big profit.
Thank you so much Pak Prof. Bohari for your response based on our questions today. And then the last, maybe for Dr. Hanilin, maybe you have some advice for us, especially for the supplier of the agriculture product to easy to find the customer. That's why the supplier can have the marketing, like marketing way to like find the customer. That's why the tourism will like the bile in the farmer, like that.
I didn't get the question well. What is it again? Because it was in Indonesian language.
Okay. Sure. Dr. Hani, this is from Kevin as the second participant who want to do some question. It's about if you have any advice for the supplier. The supplier of the agriculture product to find the customer.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, by the product of the agriculture product.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's one of the strategies of an entrepreneur is before he could come up with a product, he should always study the market first. So I always tell my students that they should first consider the market before creating the product. Because if we create the product first and then find the market, then it's the hardest route to sell your product. But if we knew that there is already a need for that, there is already a market for that, then it would be easier for us to sell the product. But in case that the product is already there, and I would advise that they find the they should match well the benefit of the product, the value of the product to the market. And they could also offer things that that other competitors are not offering. So they could catch some portions of the market that these competitors are not selling to. So, well, it's not easy to say if we are talking about general products, because each product has its own marketing strategy. So we cannot generalize this market tricks, market strategies to all products. So it will depend on the type of product, probably. But I guess the student who asked this is referring to in general, right? Product in general. So I think that would be my advice for now. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Mom Hani, for your response based on this question. So the first that we could do is study about the market first. That's why we can know about this product and which one the market who won't be going to send this product or sell this product. Thank you so much, Dr. Hani. Because Dr. Hani already responds the question, and then also from Professor Buhari, and then also from Sir Mahendra as the Paktani Digital founder is already responds all the questions. So our discussion session today, we close. Thank you so much for all our guest lecturers, and the resume of, or the conclusion from our international webinar today is the first that from the grapes or the fruits in generally, we know the chemistry inside and then how strategy to grow in the limited area. Because when we know about how strategy to grow the plants in the limited area, we know how to buy the tourism, agro-tourism, to help the tourism in generally from the agriculture. And then how to find the market is about the digital marketing from Mr. Mahendra as the founder Paktani Digital. So this is will help us to sell or promote our agriculture product to give more than quickly into the customer, into the need of customer based on the agriculture product. Thank you so much for your time, Mr. Mahendra. And then also Dr. Hanilin Hidalgo from CBCA Philippines, and then also the last from Professor Buhari from the Malaysia. Thank you so much for all participants. We apologize if any question can't we receive and go to all our guest lecturers today. And then I believe, and we believe, that this international webinar will give a bigger profit for our knowledge, to give some socialization in the farmers, especially for the digital marketing, also tourism, and then also how to grow plant in the limited area. Okay, thank you so much. And then I am, as a moderator in this international webinar, to say thank you so much for all the guest lecturers, and then also all participants in this international webinar. See you again on the next international webinar. And then thank you so much. And then I give return back time to our Mr. Master of Ceremony on this international webinar. For Ms. Aulia, time is yours.
Okay, thank you for the learning material that have been given from our wonderful guest. Also, thank you for our great moderator for guided the session. Now, we arrive at the closing part of the event today. Thank you so much for all the invited guests the present today. We apologize from my behalf if there any wrong words or action during the event. We hope that this event able to increase our knowledge regarding industry and how to optimize the use of digital marketing. Thank you for all. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Om Santi Santi Om. Sebelumnya ada foto session terlebih dahulu. Untuk semua audiens bisa menyalakan kameranya.
Yeah, you can get started. Get photo, Mom Hani, Mr. Mahendra, and Prof. Bahari is already ready.
Ready?
Thank you to the organizers. Congratulations.
You're welcome, Mom. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Congratulations, Bonnie. You did a great job.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you, Dr. Hani.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Prof.
Thank you. Thank you, Lisa. Congratulations.
Bye-bye. See you again tomorrow, Prof.
Webinar now.
Terima kasih. Hale,
Hidalgo. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Bye. Congratulations, Agung Pratama.
Congrats again. Congrats to Warmadewa University.
Thank you, madam.
Warmadewa.
Congratulations, Agung Pratama.
See you. Hello, Hani. Prof. Bob. Purisa.
Okay.
Agung Pratama.
Rasa macam di Warmadewa.
Rasa macam di Warmadewa. Memang di Warmadewa, Prof.
Aduh. Kadang tidak sampai, suara sampai ya.
Tapi foto sampai, Prof. Bob. Sudah ya. Bisa menghilangkan rasa rindu.
Selalu nampak gamo dengan cucunya.
Ya, Prof. Kegiatan sekarang jadi Sri Empu, Prof. Memang cucu. Okay.
Terima kasih untuk semua dosen Fakultas Pertanian Universitas Warmadewa. Thank you for all lecturers of Agriculture Faculty of Warmadewa University.
Baik. Thank you.